Hey, it's ShadowACS again. When it comes to gothic anime, I don't know if I consider myself an avid fan, but I definitely like plenty of them. I mean, I love DN Angel, Black Butler, and a few other shows I could probably mention. I think it's a really great idea for a genre, though, because you can get really creative when thinking up gothic designs. And with anime, there's really no boundaries to the amount of creative stuff you can put on screen. And as far as gothic anime go, one of the more interesting cases I've come across is Dusk Maiden of Amnesia. I gotta say, when I first started watching Dusk Maiden of Amnesia, I was not impressed by it. I mean, I thought it had a great setup, but for the most part, it just seemed like a bunch of wasted potential. And I really thought it was gonna be just a big chore to finish it and get to this review. But then my impression of it started to change once I got to the second half. After the first 6 or 7 episodes, not only did this show get better, it got a lot better. Almost like a completely new team of people took over the project. But with every show where the second half is immensely better than the first, you have to ask the question, is making it to the second half worth it? I know there's still probably a lot of people who hold a grudge against me for not thinking Dead Man Wonderland was a good anime, even though I did like the second half. But in the case of Dusk Maiden of Amnesia, I actually do think the second half is good enough to warrant making it past the bad parts. And on the whole, I really did enjoy this anime. But with that said, I still think the problems of the first half do get in the way, and I can think of plenty of ways in which the show could have been done better. Okay, so what's the show about? Dusk Maiden of Amnesia stars generic main character number 4,253,577, a boy named Taichi Nia. At Taichi's school, there's a legend about a girl named Yuko who died decades ago after being trapped in one of the rooms. Well, okay, not exactly a legend, more like a true story that just spawned a bunch of crazy rumors about paranormal events happening around the school. One day, Taichi's wandering around one of the old school buildings when he actually comes across the ghost of Yuko herself. Once he gets over his disbelief, he and Yuko actually manage to strike up a pretty bizarre friendship. Taichi also learns that Yuko, despite having haunted the school for over half a century, can't remember any of the details about how she died. So Taichi figures the two should look into it and find out why she couldn't pass on. In order to do this, they decide to start up a paranormal investigation club at their school, since most of the rumors about supernatural activity around the school seem to be tied back to Yuko. And as Taichi and Yuko work to discover how she died, the two gradually start to fall in love with each other. So here's how the two halves of this show are different. The first half has a lot of comedy, which isn't really that funny. A lot of focus is given to these two other girls who join up with the club who aren't really that interesting, and the story is basically a slice of life about the day-to-day adventures of this paranormal Scooby-Doo ghost hunting club, which doesn't really lead to them finding out many details about why Yuko died, which again, was why they created it in the first place. The second half is where it becomes the show I wanted to see going into it. It's much darker and more serious, and the focus is kept where it should be, on the romance and on Yuko's past. And her past, which I won't give away, is both terrifying and heartbreaking at the same time. Plus, the other two girls only play a part when they can actually benefit the story. But I suppose it's probably better not to look at this anime as two separate halves and just judge it as a whole. The best thing about Dusk Maiden of Amnesia is its atmosphere. I will say that I didn't think the gothic designs were really that impressive. I mean, the old school building just kind of looks like a generic haunted house. But they more than make up for it with some great lighting and really beautiful backgrounds. Anytime they have to show a sunset in this anime, it just looks gorgeous, like the whole sky is on fire. The show also reminds me of F: A Tale of Memories in that it uses a lot of abstract imagery to enhance the emotion. But the big difference between this and F is that the abstract stuff isn't just used for drama. Sometimes it's used to create some surprisingly suspenseful and creepy moments. And I don't mean that in a sense like it's just more creepy than you'd expect from a romance. There were parts in this anime where I was legitimately getting scared. The part where Yuko is trying to escape the school but can't make it past the front gate, I think is good enough to be in a psychological horror film. I think scenes like this are especially great because they work to show that Dusk Maiden of Amnesia is just as much a ghost story as it is a love story. And both halves are balanced out very well. Plus it gives the show a bit of a unique edge to it. I also think the romance is really great, at least once it gets going in the second half. I don't think it's quite on par with Clannad, Sword Art Online, or some of the other great anime love stories, but it is very touching, and they do throw enough obstacles in the way of their relationship to keep it from getting boring. I also think it's a lot less cliched than a lot of other romances are. Usually if the creators of a romance don't know what they're doing, they'll just resort to throwing in cheap plot devices to move the story along. You know, like maybe there'll be an evil ex-boyfriend who doesn't want the two to be together or some overused bullshit. Dusk Maiden doesn't do anything like that, so kudos. And honestly, that's pretty much where my praise of this show ends. Don't get me wrong, the good stuff in it is more than enough for me to like the anime. But everything else ranges from okay to just kind of bad. My big problem with the anime, especially the first half, is that there's a lot of fanservice-y scenes that I guess are supposed to be funny. Well, not only did I barely crack a smile during any of these, hell, I don't even want to call them comedy scenes, they're just sort of awkward, perverted moments. But they're just horribly out of place. Dusk Maiden of Amnesia is a show that, by the very nature of its premise, needs to be dark, serious, and really heavy on the drama. And when it is, it's great. But why does it need to have things like a Moa Cafe scene? Is this really what anyone wants to see in a psychological gothic drama? Actually, while watching this anime, I remember mentally drawing a lot of comparisons to Dance and the Vampire Bund, another supernatural gothic romance anime that also had a lot of awkward, out-of-place fan service. But even though the nudity in Vampire Bund is definitely more revealing, I actually think it's a lot less distracting because it's mostly kept to expositional scenes that don't really have a lot of stuff going on. And even when it's not, the show has such a thick and intense plot that it's pretty easy to overlook. But with Dusk Maiden of Amnesia, especially the first half, a lot of the scenes that are supposed to be really emotional are suddenly punctuated with awkward bits of comedic fan service. Take this one scene in the first episode where Teiichi and Yuko are trapped in a small elevator, and Yuko remarks on how amazing it feels to actually touch another person for the first time in years. Now this is a good setup for a really strong emotional scene, but instead, look what they do with it. Wow, I can practically see the whole love story falling to pieces before my very eyes. But that's not my only problem with the anime. I also think the character cast is kinda mediocre. The only one I really liked was Yuko, but even she was kinda disappointing. I think this is one case where it is reasonable to expect a great character. I mean, she's a ghost girl with no past. There's so much you can do with that. I was hoping for a character with a lot of subtle tragedy to her, kinda like C2, but also with a bit of a creepy edge to her, cause, well, she's a freaking ghost. Now, while there does seem to be an effort to give Yuko this type of personality, for the most part, she's pretty happy and upbeat. And I know the idea is that she's unconsciously thrown away all her negative emotions because of the trauma that caused her amnesia, but I still think they could have made her a little stronger. But with that said, she's still really likable, and you really do sympathize with what she's had to go through. She's had to spend decades living as an invisible entity that no one could see, hear, or feel. Which is also why it makes sense that she would fall in love with Teiichi, the first person in years she could interact with. The other characters besides Yuko aren't exactly bad, the problem is that they're just really forgettable. Teiichi, like I said, is the absolute definition of a generic main character. I know the focus of the show is supposed to be more on Yuko, but still, they could have at least attempted to give him a personality. The other two girls are also pretty weak. One of them's a blonde girl with a huge crush on Teiichi, which, oddly enough, doesn't really go anywhere, and is usually used for comic relief. And to her credit, she does get a few pretty funny scenes, but they're certainly not funny enough to warrant her taking up the amount of time in the show that she does. The other girl, I think, is a little stronger, at least because she contributes a lot more to the story, but her personality is pretty much just a generic tomboy, which is in like every other anime nowadays. Honestly, there's not a lot to her. Frankly, what I think this show should have done is ditch the two side girls and the Paranormal Investigation Club completely and just have the whole thing be about the relationship between Teiichi and Yuko, as Teiichi finds a series of clues leading to the discovery of her past. If they had done that, I think this could have been a masterpiece. Hell, if they really wanted to get stylish, what they could have done is not show any other human beings besides Teiichi and Yuko. Or they could have everyone else's faces shadowed out, sort of stylistically emphasizing how much the two mean to each other. I mean, there's already a few scenes where we see people's faces in shadow. How cool would it have been if they had done that with everyone but Teiichi and Yuko all throughout the anime? But I suppose I should probably critique this show on what it is rather than what I want it to be. And you know what? For what it is, it's a pretty damn good romance. It's got some great atmosphere and beautiful visuals, a really good love story, and a lot of great twists and turns toward the end that make getting through all the bad stuff worth it. And even the bad stuff in this show, as much as I've gone on about it, is nothing terrible. It's just really forgettable and at times mildly irritating. If you're looking for a good supernatural romance, I think this is a pretty safe bet to check out. And if you're as annoyed by some of the weaker stuff as I was, then you can take my word for it that it does get a lot better. This is ShadowACS, and I'll see you next time.